At first, my first joke is gone because I was thinking about a way to wake you up. And yeah, somebody did wake you up with some good news about free hardware, open hardware, I mean. So who I am? I'm Eric Leblon. I'm working on network since quite a few time. And I've got a little bit of imposter syndrome too. And that's why I did come after the talk from Bjorn with a legendometer. So to be able to place yourself among the god. So I'm the blue guy here, so quite small, but, oh, yeah, so you don't have my slide, that will not help a lot. So let's try again. It was working before, I did test. Okay, so that's not fun. Okay, should I reboot? And make people from power management cry? Can some... Okay, so yeah, yeah, we'll have reboot at first to be sure. Yep. Ah, we have. Okay, no. Okay. So I think we'll really reboot. Just to be on the safe side. No, let's at least close the session. No, it was working. I did test this morning. It was working properly. Okay. Okay, so is it working now? Come on. Yes, we got a bird. Yeah, I know. Okay. Yep. Mirror. Apply. Okay. No. Okay. So it's not my day. Let's go small. Out with a legendometer to be able to place you among the gods. So I did make a little Python script that get the Git history. And yes, for sure. Really not my day. So I did try to place myself in it. And as I've done some mathematics, I was able to really modelize the thing so it looks properly. But in fact, it's a logarithmic scale. So I'm the blue dot in the middle. And then I put Greg KH at 1 because I did not pick everybody. Okay, so yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I know. I just did not get properly the time to do everything. So somebody asked, so welcome to Kernel Recipe. So that was my first joke, and we already had the talk, so that's not even fun. So can somebody tell me, not French, what is on the logo? So we got the Eiffel Tower on the top left, easy. And then on the middle, what is it? Is it a cat Pokeball? But everyone did came out too and say, okay, I want some cat pictures. So yes, a cat Pokeball. So is this in fact a color issue of this logo? Yeah, no, in fact, it's just that the first conference of kernel recipes were in this place, close to this place, which is the north of Paris, which is a 3D theater called La Géode. And yes, so this is a picture of a place, and that's why you have this big ball. It's not a pokeball, it's a 3D theater. Okay, so I'm here to speak to you about Suricata. That is an intrusion detection and intrusion prevention engine. It's a GPL. It's run by a foundation, OISF. And I will just go to what it does with this graph. So the typical installation that we will talk about today is the following one. You've got Suricata running on a probe. You've got a network interface, or multiple network interface. Then you've got a copy of a traffic that come to you through a tap device or through port mirroring on the switch. And so Suricata will take packet per packet, make an analyze everything, and then split out alert event, what we call network security monitoring event. It's metadata extracted from the protocol. And then you will send that in a big in some big data thing, and then you can do some machine learning. Sorry, that's the wrong conference. I reverse. But yeah, but we generate a lot of data, and you need to use that to be able to find the threat on the network. So the key point is that we've got multiple ways to use it. We can use it via netfilter to have an IPS. So this time we are in the middle of the traffic, we block the bad traffic. And the thing that we will look at today is more the AF packet part, so we are sniffing the traffic, and we try to find the threat and to analyze the protocol inside. So we got a point-dependent detection of protocol. So this means that we will find HTTP on any port because we analyze the beginning, we analyze the content. We are doing metadata extraction. We are doing file extraction. For instance, we can do file extraction on SMB, file extraction on NFS, on HTTP2, so you got a lot of features. And we have the way to describe the threat. It is done via keyword on what we call signature. I will not get into this detail, and we have got some protocols. So for instance, you can say, if I see this HTTP user agent in the flow that is going to this website, then in this case, I want an alert because it's not something normal. So what Suricata is doing? So it gets a copy of the traffic, and then it does all the job of the operating system. The idea is to provide to the threat detection engine a stream of a stream for every traffic that we see. So we do the reconstruction, we do the TCP window check, we do the TCP segment reassembly, we do everything the same way as the operating system. And the same way as all the operating system that we can see. So we got TCP reconstruction for Windows, we got TCP reconstruction for Linux. We take care of this one because the people in front of us, they have toolkit. So you can say, attack this box, dash dash, evade IDS, and they will apply some methods that are well known to be able to avoid the detection. So we really need to have a proper way to do it correctly, and that's a big job. And we go to the HTTP layer, so we have normalization of event, and that's the best place to put the security rule. The final objective is to be able to generate this kind of event in JSON. So for instance, here we got an alert, which was on the mail because we did detect that the mail recipient was one person. Okay, so some context. Suricata is a passive sniffer. We work on the traffic duplication. As we are doing that, we have no influence at all on the traffic. So if it goes too fast, that's our problem. We need to deal with that. We cannot do anything. We need to deal with the traffic is too fast for our CPU power, and we need to fix that. We cannot do packet drop or thing like that, to slow down thing, play on retransmission, we have no influence on the network. We just need to deal with what we have. And we need to minimize the packet loss, because if we lose packet, all the reconstruction I did show you, it will fail at some point. And if it fails at some point, we will miss a security event, and we will miss a file extraction. So to give you an idea, if you have 10%, if you have 3% of packet loss, you miss 10% of the alert. So you really need to deal with that. And it's even worse with the packet loss for file extraction, because you've got 50% of file extraction failing with only 5% of packet loss. And I think we already reached something at 0.5% of packet loss. We already reached something like 10% of missed file extraction. So, yeah, exactly. That was a perfect timing. So what we need to do is to be able to see something. So the best way to do this is to do load balancing. So the typical load balancing is the following. We put the different layer of treatment on different thread, and we do the treatment on this thread. So yeah, you say, okay, problem fixed. I just need big CPU, powerful, and everything is good. Okay. So what happened? If, like in any company, the people are testing the backup, doing backup. So you have some big, huge flow that came. So if you take the wire, you got almost all the traffic is from this flow. And then you do the flow-based load balancing, and you end up with one of the threads fully booked with this thing. And then you've got drop from this backup, but also from the overflow that would have been reached CPU. So you end up with really a big loss in terms of accuracy in the detection. So we need a way to get rid of that. So the easy solution to say, oh, I just need a bigger ring buffer. If it's a backup, you need a terabyte of ring buffer. So nah, not going to work. So that cannot work. So one solution is to use bypass. And to do so, the idea is simple. You see that the flow is a big flow, or it has some property that you don't want to look at, you don't want anymore to look at it, and then you say, I tag it as bypass, I will maintain a table of bypass flow, and as soon as the packet belongs to this flow, I will bypass it, and I will not do the CPU intensive work on it. So we have two ways to do this bypass in Suricata. One way is the local bypass. We see the packet, we look into our internal flow table, and they say, oh, this packet is belonging to this bypass flow, I don't want to see it anymore. So we manage to do bypass like that, but it's already have done through multiple layers, so that's not perfect. And we've got the capture bypass. Here, the capture method will get the packet and do the same job, but earlier in the stack. So the local bypass is just like this. We got the kernel, we get out of the kernel after Hive packet, we read the packet from the Hive packet socket, and then we do a bypass at this stage. So we already have occasion to lose packet here and lose packet here. The capture bypass, it's a bit better. We just, before injecting in the different ring buffer from the Hive packet capture method, we already have done the bypass, so we managed to get the big flow out of our system. We have various ways to do the stream bypass. One easy way that we have is that we have something that we call the stream reassembly def. We don't usually we don't do the reassembly to the really big amount of data. So we can say, okay, if I've seen already two megabyte of this flow, I think it's the same one. I will stop inspecting it. So we can use that to say, I want to bypass the stream as soon as I did inspect enough in the session. Or you can have a selective bypass, like you want to ignore some intensive traffic like Netflix, and you can use a signature. So basically, as soon as I got HTTP, and the content is suricata.io, so one of the domain of Suricata, I want to bypass it. In the HTTP host, I want to bypass it. So this way we managed to have OR bypass for this streamdef. We also bypass TLS encrypted data. So as soon as we see that the TLS is switching to encryption after the uncheck, we say, okay, I don't want to see that anymore. And then this way we can bypass a lot of traffic. So I was the guy that did implement that into Suricata. That was a long journey. It did start in February 17 with the Bypass API inside Suricata, an NFU implementation. I did present that at NetDev in Sevilla. And then at the time, some crazy people were talking about a new crazy stuff called XDP. And I was like, okay, maybe we can use this thing to do bypass into Suricata and fix the problem on Hive Packet, because if you consider Hive Packet at the time, it was not possible to maintain a float table, but with eBPF on XDP, it was really looking like a solution. So I did implement that for Suricata 4.1, and in Suricata 5.0, that will be released later this year, I did do a lot of supplementary work, and the main one was to be able to do hardware bypass in Netronome. I will get into detail into that later. Okay, XDP bypass. So at the beginning, it was quite some fun because nothing was ready. So I did try to use libbpf to edit. No, the first attempt was to try to parse myself the ELF file and load the eBPF filter inside the kernel. Okay, I'm not a good enough developer to do that. So hopefully there was libbpf, but it was not really ready, so I had to patch it to make it work. But the idea is the one, you load the eBPF filter in with libbpf, you set up the map, so the maps will be a floatable, and the eBPF filter will be really simple. I just extract the tuple IP source, IP destination, port source, port destination, basically, and I will check it against the map to see if it belongs to the list of it belongs to a flow that has to be bypassed. If it's the case, I drop the packet. If it's not the case, the packet goes through. And Suricata is the one in charge of inserting elements in the floatable and removing them, because it's complicated to have an update of the floatable during the packet life. So the first implementation of a floatable in Suricata 4.1 was based on a floatable dump. So every 30 seconds, I think I remember I did do that. Every 30 seconds, I was dumping the floatable and check if I had some entry that did expire. So I did do that. The eBPF file, in fact, as soon as you see a packet of flow belonging to a flow in the floatable, it updates the last seen. So I can know when the packet when a packet has last seen last been seen on in a flow in the floatable, and then using this, I'm able to say, okay, this needs to expire because there was no packet in 30 seconds, there was no packet in 5 minutes, so I can do the expiration like that. But the downside of that is that I need to iterate on the table, on the floatable, on the map. And this part is really, really slow. And it seems that some people did work at Christmas to make it even slower because we depend on syscall. And we do a syscall to get the next item, and then we do a syscall to get the value of the item. And we do that on 300,000 entries because we are dealing with big network, high-speed network. So this means that we need a lot of flow in the flow table. So that's really a problem. And we had, I think, up to 30 seconds in some tests to dump the table. So that was one CPU block for 30 seconds to do that. That's really bad. And some side effect of this was that we were only doing accounting at the end, so we got some spike, like the backup is finishing, and then we got 1 terabyte of data added to the accounting, and that was not really convenient. So we will see how we did this move. The last thing I did work on it, the last big thing was XDP in hardware mode. In fact, I was able to access to some Netronome cards and to the developer of the Netronome cards, which was really convenient to be able to understand how to make the bypass. So the idea is that instead of running the code inside the kernel, the code will directly run in the card. So how does it work? For me, it's just magical. I say, please, little network card, take this eBPF file, load it, and work with it. And it really works like that, because I take my eBPF code, I send it to them, the maps are available, so we can just do the same thing as before, and it works. So, no, not really. We have some limitation, we need to get around, but basically it's exactly that. I've got now the same code, almost, that is sent to the Netronome card or that is sent to the kernel. That's the same code base. And yeah, how to do that with libbpf now support installing the filter in hardware, so it's just one more call in the libbpf during the init, that's really easy. So we had some hardware constraint. One of the problems that we have is that getting the timestamp in the eBPF file was really costly on Netronome card. So updating the last scene was not doable anymore. There was also some other constraint, like a limited key value size, so we did fix by compressing the field. No per CPU map, because we have a lot of parallel treatment, so the per CPU is too big. So you need to switch to a map that is not per CPU and use Atomic. And there is some XGP feature that we have been implemented sur Yukata 4.1, like the CPU redirect, that are just really things that you need on when it's done into the kernel, so it's not supported by the cart. So basically, with some ifdef, we managed to get it working correctly. The flow compression, so yes, that was one big job. That was, I think, the most complicated code I've done for this part. So we had a U32 for IP proto. We are just bypassing for TCP and UDP. So yeah, we can make it one bit. And yes, because having a U32 to code IP proto was like to get to the toilet and use a kitten to clean yourself. I don't know what the marketing did think when they did that. It was in Montreal, Quebec. So, as we did not get the timestamp anymore, we did need to update the algorithm. So it was proposed by somebody from Netronome. It was just do the accounting. The switch was the following: just do the accounting of a packet in the flow table, store the accounting in the user space. So this way, you just get when you want to time out an entry, you fetch the entry instead of iterating on all the table regularly. You just fetch the entry when you want to time out from Suricata. And if you see packet on the session, then in this case it means that it's still active. So you update your counter inside Suricata and you wait for the next timeout. So it's really easy. And it's really efficient because we skip the looping on the flow table, so we just have far less syscall, so it's it's really faster. And the good thing is that it works on Netronome card, so we can really do obtain our system. So we fix the previous system, and we have a system that is working on the hardware offload. And it has also some other effect. As we are increasing the counter every time we time out, it means we try to time out. It means that we are able to increase the value of the counter in the flow. So we even have intermediate accounting for the flow, so we get some almost real-time info on the bypass activity. There was also some nice side effect. One side effect of using Netronome was the resave side scaling. So for the one who don't know it, it's a technology that allows you to distribute from the network card the load of the traffic following some certain rules on the different queue, where you put finally some CPU behind. And so Netronome has all of the modern cards support RSS, but it's even better because we support programmable RSS. So yeah, that was, I think, one of the worst code I've ever written. The API is just wonderful. It's just, you take the XDP context, you've got RxQ index, and then you set it to the value you want. I was thinking, okay, how will I use this feature? And it came out that it was one of the simplest features ever to use. And the good thing that with that is that it fixed a really old problem inside Suricata, which is the fact that we need all the packets to be ordered properly, all the packets from one flow to come on one single thread so we can do the reconstruction correctly. And by doing this, we really have the issue. And yeah, so this problem was seems super simple, but in fact, if you think that you can have defragmented packet, it means that you will not have the source port and the destination port because it's just an IP packet. So this way, you cannot do the load balancing, and all the load balancing from the network card by default for RSS, they are doing the following. It's get the hash, and send it to the get a hash based on the tuple, and put zero if ever you don't have source port and destination port. And the result was that you got the first packet of a defragmented IP packet, it reached one thread, and the rest is coming to another thread because you don't have the source port anymore. And this caused a massive drop into the accuracy of Suricata. Yep, some other usage of XDP. Yeah, so I don't know if you know the Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. I think almost everybody should have known about it. But one of my favorite parts is when the whale is coming to life in the sky and falling to the ground and say hello ground because she thinks they can be friends. Yes, and that's exactly the same for Suricata. When it starts, imagine that your work is to understand what is going on in the network, and then you start in the middle of 40 gigabytes per second of network. It's like, who's this guy? Who's this guy? Who's this guy? You don't know where to look at, and you've got big flow that you take in the middle. So, for instance, you can take an encrypted session in the middle. What is that? It's just noise. You can take HTTP in the middle too. So, yes, that's really complicated. And if you look at the previous thing, like something like a flow that has been bypassed that is really big, you will take all these packets at once, and then it's really complicated to know what you can do. So to fix that restart issue, one thing that we can do is to use pin maps for the flow table. So as when you put eBPF filter on in XDP, you can make it stay even if the calling process is dying. So we are just using that to say, okay, I will put the eBPF map, I will keep the flow table, and this way, when I restart Suricata, I will not see the bypass packet anymore. But as you have seen, timeouting the flow is done by Suricata, so we need a way to get the flow back and to ingest them into the Suricata flow table, so we can time out them, or we will just have a flow table that will grow up and will never decrease, and at the end it will be full. So to do that, we just have a task at the start of Suricata that if it knows it is using pin maps, it will dump the flow table and reconstruct a flow entry inside the Suricata flow table based on that. And this way we manage to get to time out the flow from one Suricata session to another. And and we obtain the goal that Suricata is not seeing a lot of traffic that is currently bypassed. So that's really interesting. The problem of the elephant flow is a big one. And something that is really powerful to create elephant flow is the tunneling. So if you are in the mobile network or in some cloud system, you will have a JRE tunneling to send packets from one side to another. And inside this JRE tunnel, you may have a traffic of thousands of systems. So this means you have just one big session that will reach one single thread. And if you trip one single thread, you're dead. So we need a way to load balance that in a better way. And it can just be done by using the XDP feature of making an offset of changing the start of the data. So what we can just do, in fact, is say, OK, I don't want to receive in the IF packet socket the tunnel. I'm not interested by the tunnel. What I want is the inner traffic. So to do that, I just need to parse to get the parse the beginning of a packet to get the offset of the inner data and then move the start of the data to this place. So it is just done by parsing the data. And in this case, it's the JRE code. So hop, I get the protocol. Oh, it's JRE. OK, great. I do the parsing. I check that I will not get out of the data because eBPF will fail if you do not do that. And then I call the BPF XDP I just had to just specify that the new start of the data is this point. And then after I can continue my treatment. And I will not see the JRE tunnel, but I will see the inner data. And then the load balancing will be properly done. One other side effect that we had was as I said before, we had a feature to say Suricata is analyzing the TLS session, is doing only the analysis on the TLS on-check. And then after, we have a feature to say, OK, now we've got this session is encrypted, I don't want to see it anymore, bypass. So the idea looked quite nice. You say, OK, if I don't see the encrypted traffic, that would be just lovely. But in fact, in real life, you have a lot of small sessions for HTTPS, and we have big ring buffer. So the consequence is that in something like, I think it's something like 70% of 80% of the sessions are really small, and they are already in the ring buffer when we take the decision to bypass. So this means that, OK, we did trigger some useless load because the time it reached the floatable is already out, it's already closed, so that's not working really well. So a way to do that, it's simply to fight this is simply to do some pattern-based bypass. So we take the application, we go to the application data, we check that it's TLS 1.2, and then after, TLS is well done enough in 1.2 to you just have some value to check to know that it's an encrypted packet, and then you can just drop it. And if you want to be fancy, you can add a map to have some counter. So this way, you know how many elements have been seen, have been impacted by this bypass. Okay, so I think my journey was done, and then people did come with IX6DP, so it was another start. Not a new hub, but another start. So what is IX6DP? The problem that we have with Suricata is that when we get the packet from IF packet, we already have everything in the kernel that has been done, like allocating the SKB, things like that, preparing the routing. And that's something that we don't really care because in our context, we will just redo all the same thing inside Suricata. So it's a bit stupid to do twice the job for this packet. And IFXDP is fixing this because we can take from XDP the decision to send the packet to user space and skipping all the SKB creation on all the kernel things. So for us, it's really just a perfect use case because we were really doing some useless work. So it's a new capture method and nicely done. It's implemented in libbpf, so you can just bind to the new XSK socket by using libbpf. So the API is really nice. It has two API, high-level API in libbpf to get the call done in a few calls. You also have a low-level API if you need to do morphing. One thing that did surprise me, but I already have seen that before in DPDK, was the fact that you need to bind to a queue. So what if you want to play with it on a system that has, do not have multiple queue, but do we really need that because it's for high performance? Yeah, so that's, I think that's really okay. So I did do a POC on that, on Suricata, okay, I can join, okay, I can get some packet, and then, okay, now I need the, I don't have a timestamp. Okay, so why we need the timestamp? Because we take the information from the network, and we got some people trying to play with out-of-order packet, changing things to confuse the operating system on the other side. The only thing that we really trust is the timestamp and the hardware timestamp. Because the rest can be faked, the rest can be scrambled. So we need to see when it's scrambled. We are not acting with regular traffic. We want to detect when somebody is trying to trick us. So there is no timestamp available in IFXDP. And it's mandatory for a use case. And it's also, we have another use case that would be really nice if to fix if we have a hardware timestamp. Usually what we have in high bandwidth case, it's an optical connection. And the optical connection, we got the duplication of the traffic via an optical tab device. So basically it's just a prism that split the traffic in two parts. And the effect that you have in Suricata is that you get one interface that gets the RX traffic of one port and one interface that gets the TTX traffic of the other port. So you got two interfaces, one is for the one way and the other one is for another way. And so if we want to deal with that, we need to be able to reorder the packet to have a correct representation. If we don't have the hardware timestamp, we will not be able to reorder the packet, and that means that we will not see what is really happening on the network, but some artifact around that. So I think Suricata was one of the first software to, some first generic software to implement all this eBPF XDP. And the problem that we have is that we need to get this reach all the distribution. So people, all your users on Red Hat, CentOS, Fedora, Debian, Ubuntu, etc., can use it. When the project did start, there was no de facto standard for only eBPF. Now, hopefully, we have eBPF and it seems to be the standard. A lot of things are just going straight into eBPF, so it's really nice. And eBPF is now available in most distributions, so that's really cool. One thing that was a bit messy was the change of API inside the eBPF, like the verifier need, is improved, and then it means that you need to change your code to deal with a new version of the verifier. The example I had before was this one. Yeah, this one. Before this one, this check was not necessary before. So you could just do the parsing. Now it is the verifier check that you did check, that you were not reading out of band. So you need to have this this thing. So that was a fix, but you need to follow up. Hopefully it's compatible with upstream, so that's okay. I mean with a lower version. That's good. So this is improving. It, at the beginning, it was a bit like shaky. One big thing, and I think that's common needs, is that we have no commodity decoding, so we need to decode by your own code everything. There is some example in the Linux tree, but they are not good enough, so you don't really know how to mix them. So it would be nice if we have, what Jesper was talking about before, could we have some BPF helper to say, parse me this IP packet and get me the tuple or something like that? Let's dream a little bit. Or to have some existing library that are known, okay, parsing of IP packet, like a function that we can use. So reusable block. And I think if we cover that for the main IP layers, so layer 3 and to layer 2, that will be really nice. Another point is the dealing with distribution of eBPF. So the one So the libpf problem is fixed, so it's easy to get it into this. It's in mass distribution now, so it's easy to build thanks to the GitHub repository that now hosts libpf, a copy of libpf. So that's nice because you don't need to clone the clone the kernel anymore to just get out a 100k library. So, but one issue that we have is, I think it has been expressed in a previous talk, is the fact that when we want to ship an eBPF file that will work for all the use case. And the use case depends on the hardware, and we don't control the hardware of our user. So this means that your eBPF should be able to adapt to the use case and should be able to be adapted to the use case by the user. One way to do this is the way that we did currently choose is to have a lot of ifdef on define at the beginning of the eBPF file, but this means that you need to build the eBPF on the target or close to the target to be able to ship it. So in the case of a distribution, it means that you need some more work. You cannot just say I want it to be to run like that. So another way to do this will be to have some pin maps to say this feature is active, this feature is inactive, but it will not even work because in some case, like the case of the you want to do a hardware bypass in Netronome, in this case you have features that are not really accessible and then eBPF will complain if the thing is built in, like some map type are not supported. So we really need some ifdef. So yes, so we have a problem with distribution of that because in terms of, if you say, oh, I just need C-Lang on LLVM toolkit on my production system, I think Alexei was talking about a better solution that we have, but anyway, you need a compiler on the system, so that's really nasty in terms of security. So yeah, there is a problem with the distribution of eBPF file when you want them to be generic. Okay, so yes, it was quite a long journey. I'm really happy with the outcome, and a lot of people start to using it. I've seen yesterday a tweet about some people analyzing 400 gigabytes per second of traffic with a load balancer on some 40 gigs Suricata behind, and they were using the hardware bypass inside Netronome, so that's really cool. I think IF6DP will be really promising. I just need the timestamp to be able to use it properly. I did write a white paper on the Suricata and XDP usage. So if you want to get into the detail of all the features I did implement and why it was useful for us to use that. So it's everything is upstream. So Suricata code get all my code on XDP and eBPF. And yes, there is a pointer to the libpf file. And so if you got questions, and thanks to Alexei, Daniel Borkman, Jesper, and the Netronome team that has been really, really helpful to make this hardware offload possible. So David Beckett, Jakub Kizinski, and Yong Wang. And that's it. So do you have questions?
If you don't have the timestamp, at least for a single port, you could replace it with a counter. Because what you need is to make sure that your packets are ordered when they are delivered to multiple queues, for example. And if at least you can implement a counter inside the card, it will be better than nothing because you will be able to keep ordering it. You just have to pretend that it is your timestamp and that's all. But it will not work for the case where you have a split port.
Yep. Interesting.
Hi Rick, thanks for the talk. About the Netronome cards, so they have native support for eBPF bytecode?
Yes, it's really that. So you just need to tune it a little bit to be sure that all that is supported in the card is available, but almost everything you can need is supported. And then you just load it like with libpf, specify an overcall to say, I want it to go to hardware, and that's all. That's really magical.
Okay. So is it because they actually run Linux inside the network card, or
No, no, I think they have some, I may say some mistake, but I think the firmware has a converter, has a system to convert the eBPF code to their FPGA code.
And would something like that work for other network cards with filtering engine inside? Some kind of
for me, that's the only one that did support properly the eBPF. I did not see anybody else that did implement that to this point.
Some other network cards have filtering engine inside.
Yeah.
And would it be possible to write an eBPF bytecode to the proprietary and filtering engine? And be able to use the TP hardware.
There is somebody that could answer the question behind.
Actually, it was the question I wanted to ask. I wanted your opinion about hardware offload in general, because I know some devices. So, about eBPF, only Netronom can pass eBPF now, but there are a lot of some, we could call them some smart NICs or just good NICs that are able to do most of the processing you are doing here, like flow steering, flow edging, flow actions, like drop. Even pattern matching can be done in hardware offload in general. So what is your opinion? Do you want to try it this way?
My opinion is that it's my opinion, in fact. So the my is important, because I'm the only one working on this subject currently. So I cannot do the code for Mellanox. I cannot do the code for another vendor. And the fact that we have something that almost all the code was common with kernel version. That was really where I did see the advantage, because if you look at the diff between the kernel version and the Netronom hardware offload version, it's almost nothing. So the support of eBPF for that is invaluable, because if ever somebody else is now exactly like that you are saying, is it now making able the eBPF to be loaded on the card, then we will have now two vendors supported. And if I want to do this with a proprietary API, yes, I can do it. It will be a project. But I will do this for all the vendors, so that's the problem.
Okay, so your issue is about API. So we are back to the question, can we have some standard API for this kind of thing? Just for information, in DeepDK there is an API called RTFlow, which is quite standard and supported by many vendors.
Yep.
I'd just like to say there is a standard API, the ETH tool API supports that, but the logging on that might be too heavyweight for you.
Yeah, so to make some offload, to make some flow offload, yeah. Yeah, I've seen that. I did not get the time to use it.
A month ago, Netflix submitted in kernel TLS support in FreeBSD. And I was wondering, today with initiatives like Let's Encrypt and Mozilla trying to enforce DNS traffic over HTTPS, isn't that making you somewhat less relevant? Or when you see Suricata used by companies, they terminate TLS at the edge and then they get clear traffic inside their infrastructure. And so the question is, I did not follow that. Is there such an initiative to have in kernel TLS support in Linux? And are you aware of that?
Yeah, so there is some TLS support inside the Linux kernel. And to get back to your previous question, yes, TLS is hiding a lot of things. The OASF, the foundation behind Suricata, will not do decryption, but we can work with decryption. That's something that is possible. And if you, that's one point, so you can decrypt. Some people are doing it. And the other answer is that we are more and more focusing on lateral movement. Instead, before it was what we call north-south, like internet traffic, now we go east-west. To detect lateral movement, and in this area, we've got Samba, Windows, and these things are not moving fast. So we have a few years in front of us before it gets completely irrelevant. But I agree, there is a switch the north-south is getting less interesting because I've seen companies where they have 90% of the traffic is HTTPS. But the 10%, the 10 remaining percent are really interesting. And
okay, so then we're getting TLS support in the kernel, and HTTP3 is moving us to Quick, which is UDP based, and all you see is source and destination and a single bit, and the rest is encrypted. How do we deal with that?
Yeah, we don't deal with that. That's not possible. So yeah, so the thing that we can do deal with that is to get back to older method in terms of detection, but with a new twist, which is to extract the flow information. So okay, if I start to communicate with an IP in China, and it is done every hours on my internal system, that is a server, is it normal? This kind of thing. And then you got some machine learning going. Sorry if it's not a good conf, but that's really what people are doing to try to deal with that.
Okay.
Hi, have you tried to fuzz the system?
Yeah. So we have we are using American Fuzzy Loop quite heavily inside Suricata.
Cool. And what are the results? Have you found anything?
The result, I think, it's a 30 patch in the latest week. No, we were already fuzzing, but it has been improved in some part because the problem that the American Fuzzy Loop, the concept is that you start the engine, you start a binary, and you make it crash by injecting some wrong data inside, and the wrong data are handled by American Fuzzy Loop. That's the ID, but when you start Suricata, it takes 30 seconds to start, so the fuzzing is not really efficient, so that's why we have some custom running mode where we say, I want to fuzz this application layer, I want to fuzz this other application layer. So we have done that, and one big part was missing, so that's why we did get some recent results, but we are using American Fuzzy Loop since a few years now, maybe 5 or 6.
Mm-hmm. You may also consider Leap Fuzzer because it works in process. It doesn't need to start the process each time.
Okay. I will get the information to the people doing that.
Thanks for the talk. With this early dropping of the packets, there is the risk that somebody can just bypass with like playing.
Yeah, sure. So you have a TLS 1.2 encrypted packet bypass is something that is not activated by default.
Okay.
So it's really it's the usual question with Suricata is, okay, if I take that, so if, for instance, if you lose 10% of packet, it means that you will lose almost all the accuracy of the system. So it's better to improve the packet loss and maybe have a backdoor on some TLS-like traffic. It's really a question of decision, but we let the decision to the user. We know that it's a security potential security issue, that's why it's not activated by default, but if you need it, you can activate it. Thanks.